It's CCSD Today, your insider's guide to the Charleston County School District. This week, we get an inside look at Education That Opens Doors Strategic Planning Symposium. Hear Dr. Jarita Postlewaite's opening speech. And go behind the scenes of the symposium. CCSD Today starts right now.
Welcome to another edition of CCSD Today. I'm your host, Erica Taylor, and I'm standing here at Burke High School where we're having the Educator Symposium, Education That Opens Doors. During the symposium, we are learning about all of these phenomenal techniques, strategies, and initiatives that we're going to use to make the success of the students in Charleston County School District even better. Stay tuned. You're watching CCSD Today, and we'll be right back.
The law firm of Young Clement Rivers has been serving the Charleston Low Country since 1968. All of the lawyers of Young Clement Rivers are proud to be partners with the Charleston County School District. We are convinced that the hard work of the school district employees and staff prepares our young people to face the challenges of the future. We look forward to continuing our partnership and in helping the school district to meet its standard of excellence.
On January 28th, the Charleston County School District held the Education That Opens Doors Strategic Planning Symposium at Burke High School. It was an opportunity to engage in conversation about district strategies to ensure college, career, and citizenship readiness for all students. Superintendent Dr. Jarita Postlewaite got the symposium off to an amazing start with her opening speech.
Last spring, when the Strategic Planning Committee met, they were 35 people representing all walks of life, business people, clergy, community members, parents, and educators. They came out of that 2.5-day planning event with 5 strategies. We will embrace students' agency in every aspect of their education. In other words, their self-direction, their responsibleness, their resourcefulness, their self-actualization. We'll redefine teaching and learning. We'll nurture an ethical culture of excellence. We'll ensure the organization is effective. And we'll create a mutually respectful bond with all segments of the community. This morning, we're talking about those strategies in 4 kind of pieces. The readiness, if kids are self-directed and can access, retrieve, process, produce information, have the right kinds of skills and attributes, they will be able to engage productively after school. Relevance, making sure that what we're teaching and the ways we're teaching and creating learning environments fit today's world and today's kids. Responsiveness, ensuring that our organization is adapting and responding to the needs of people, the children in our school system and those in the community. And finally, relationships. And that's one of the reasons we're here this morning, to start beginning to come together, to stay together, to use our hearts, our minds, our energies, to say, what can we do on behalf of the youth of Charleston County? We want to start by just saying there are some barriers. The biggest barrier we face is that the system, the K-12 system in which we work and live, was never, ever designed to bring all of the children to high levels of achievement. It's a bell curve system where some kids get A's and B's, and others get C's and D's, and pretty much we move them through the system. And because we've had that system for so long, the traditions of that system are in our DNA. Many of us who work in the system and those for whom the system works have a sense of complacency about that. But if the system doesn't work for you or was never intended to work for you, you might have deep anger, which leads to distrust and despair. So we bring all of those realities into this work with us, and we simply wanted to acknowledge them as we start. We want to recall the words of Ron Edmonds, one of the original effective schools researchers from the late 70s and early 80s, who found schools here and there who had high poverty populations, but who were bringing all of their children to high levels of achievement. He asked, how many effective schools would you have to see in order to be persuaded of the educability of poor children? If your answer is more than one, then I suggest you have reasons of your own for persisting in your belief that home background is the biggest determinant of education success. He famously said, we can, whenever and wherever we choose, successfully teach all children whose schooling is of interest to us. Whether or not we do that must finally depend on how we feel about the fact that we haven't done it so far. We can do it in one school and a school here and a school here, but our nation has never learned how to scale those successes across a system. That's what we're hoping to do in Charleston County in the weeks and months and years to come. How do we transform teaching and learning from the kind of batch processing bell curve system we have to a system that operates differently? Let's look at what our goals are for our graduates. 2 years ago, South Carolina adopted a brand new aspiration for its graduates. We live in a state where the Constitution calls for a minimally adequate education for its children. And yet, we have a state board, the legislature, the business community that have come together and say, we want our kids not only to have deep knowledge, to have foreign languages, science, technology, education, mathematics training, to be well-versed in a number of subjects, but we want to make sure that they have the kinds of world-class skills, creativity, problem-solving, the ability to process information and sort out sense from nonsense, news from non-news. And then we want them to have the kind of skills we all need to work and live and exist together. So we think about readiness and relevance in terms of those kinds of dimensions. And then we look locally at the kind of opportunities we have. We have a real opportunity to break some deep cycles of poverty in our community, to benefit our local citizens, instead of the employers who are coming to us from around the world to situate here, having to bring in 25 to 30 people per day to fill jobs. We can get our own citizenry ready for those jobs, but most of them require very high levels of skill, of thought process, of problem solving, of creativity, critical thinking. And we've got to think about how to improve up our game, reach more kids, and close that opportunity gap. That means we have to be more responsive. A responsive system, I think of as the sort of the climbing walls that we see. We intend for every child to get to the top of that wall. They may go up a little bit differently, and what we have is harnesses and supports and encouragement to help them go whatever way they need to get up the wall. We expect success for all. We can only get there if we stop doing 1,000 different things and get really clear on what makes a difference for kids, support and develop our teachers to be able to deliver those things with fidelity every day, on time, all the time. That's the only way our system's going to reach these high goals that we've set for our kids. And then finally, there has to be a relentless intentionality about our work. We cannot be relaxed. We cannot be take for granted things are going to turn out. We have to be looking at our outcomes all the time. That means we have to find a better way to measure where kids are on the growth chart. Until the latest technologies came into place, we didn't have a way to do that. But now there are technologies that let us know by studies of the test results, the achievement results of millions of Americans who are, say, age 25 to 30. When we look, go back and look and see where they were in kindergarten, where were they scoring in the third grade, it allows researchers to say, there are four different ways we can tell you where your third grader or your fifth grader or your eighth grader is with respect to four different kinds of goals. This line would be the line that a child would need to be on, the achievement level, if he were going to try to go to an Ivy League college, an Ivy League university, a Harvard, a Stanford, a Columbia, a Duke, a Furman, so forth. That's that line. If we were going to try to get into state universities, USC, for example, Clemson, this would be where the achievement would have to fall. This is for Trident Technical College, and this line is right now where the military, the Army, has the ASVAB score sets. Then what we can say to every parent, for any child, this is where your child is. Our job is to make sure we grow that child in order to be in the military, Trident Tech, a four-year college, or Harvard. This is where your child needs to be, so let's work together and make sure we're getting the growth we need. We can look at the beginning of the year, at the middle of the year, and the end of the year. And if what we've been doing isn't working, then we'll revise what we're doing. That's what it means to be responsive. We're responding to where kids are, not to where the curriculum pacing guide said we needed to be today, with the idea that every child needs to be growing all the time. It means that we take all these different things we have going on in our system and align them so that we're all working inside the system and the partnerships that are working with us, heading our efforts together toward every student being prepared. That continual growth and the kind of metrics we'll report to the community is how much growth a school is getting. Finally, that fourth R, the relationships. And that's why we're here this morning, to start building, we hope, mutually trustful, respectful relationships involving you, sharing with you what we're doing, and building from here to say, how do we rethink what we've been doing? Make what's working even better for the children for whom it is working, and totally change what has resulted in very disappointing outcomes for some of our kids. Now, there's a lot going on in our system that's kind of represented in all of these hexagons that you see here. The most important three are the improved achievement, which comes, we think, with redefining teaching and learning and the way we measure, recruiting and supporting top talent, and putting in place a lot of different kinds of student supports. I've talked a bit about the metrics and the dashboard, the different way we're looking at student achievement results. I haven't said anything about access and opportunity, but we want to tell you there is a huge push to look at diversity training and making sure all of us understand our biases, how those biases emerge in the work we do every day, in looking at our magnet school, partial magnet options, rethinking how we get opportunities to every child in every part of our huge school district. Our purpose for today, in a word, is to put our heads together to see what good we can do for our children. How can we unite? How can we stay together? How can we measure our successes? How can we handle our tensions and disagreements so that they don't bog us down and cause us to lose attention and focus and motivation toward those things that we are beginning to see are making a positive difference? Change leadership is very difficult. Being an educator today is not for wimps. It is hard work. Your heart has to be in it. You have to care more about kids than you care about caustic criticism. You must commit and care and stay the course, even though it is very difficult work. From my point of view, it's God's work, and we're about it every day, but it's hard. Michael Fullan said, leading change is like starting out on a planned journey in uncharted waters on a leaky boat with a mutinous crew. Change is very, very hard, but we are committed to it, and we pledge to you that we are here to make a difference for all of the kids. We just want to remind ourselves of something that local historian Charles Joyner said. Some may say there's been no progress, but they've forgotten where we started. Some would stop here, for they cannot see how far we have to go. We know we have a long way to go, but we also know we stand on the shoulders of other great educators who came before us. There are some rich and wonderful traditions, and there's some tragic history to overcome. We acknowledge all of that as we invite you into our homes, into our hearts, to say, what together might we do for our children? Thank you.
I did not choose teaching so much as I think teaching chose me. I love it. I don't consider it so much a job as I do a passion. One of the most important things is getting to know the kids so I can be a better teacher and I can help them feel successful and I can help them feel confident in just being who they are, accepting who they are, accepting and celebrating their differences. It's been an amazing environment, great community. I couldn't be more proud representing Charleston County.
Kids learn it at their own pace, to remediate on their own, see their own results, celebrate their successes right there.
I think it's easier for me to do things like online, like it captures my attention better than like doing it in books.
It's just made it easy. It's made it easy, and the kids like it.
There are a lot of pictures. Sometimes it can be really funny, and some stories are make-believe.
I would never have believed that we would be a school that would be fully, you know, implementing technology in every classroom. So we did it, and it's due to McGraw-Hill.
During the symposium, educators, CCSD Today staff, and community members had a chance to participate in focus information sessions and facilitated stakeholder discussions with themes like ensuring organizational effectiveness, redefining teaching and learning, and increasing college and career readiness. These sessions were a great success.
The message that I'm hearing today is that Charleston County School District would like to develop partnerships with their parents. They want to get the information out to their teachers and their schools that Charleston County is trying to prepare students and scholars to become career ready, college ready, and amped up to take on all the opportunities that are coming into Charleston.
I think one of the things I came away with today is how complex the finances are for the district and how they come from a number of pots of money. Some locally funded, some state funded, and then some federal funding, and how all that works together to educate the students, and then how difficult it is to actually go through and budget the revenues and match it up to the expenses.
We really got to reach out, use technology to integrate our kids with it, because once they get out in the workforce, that's what they're going to be using. More and more jobs are going towards technology-based, and if the kids don't know how to use it and they're not familiar with it, they're going to fall behind, even more so than what they are right now. So we really got to integrate that in our classrooms.
A big picture, it's just great to get together with everyone on a Saturday morning. I mean, this is a community pulling together, volunteering some time to talk about some big picture items and drill down a little bit and give us some direction where we need to go.
Actually, I was sitting right next to a parent and she was excited to hear about the opportunities that were available for her child who is in an elementary school right now. And so right now that's one of our target audiences. So we want to start talking to our elementary parents, letting them know that you want to keep your child here in Charleston County School District so they can grow and become to take a part of the services and all the resources that we have again, so that they can take those big jobs at Volvo and Boeing and all of those great places.
You know, just having a forum where you have everyone from teachers, board members, all together in one room talking about some things is a real opportunity.
Dr. Postlewaite has passion that's really very centered on the big picture, and that's student achievement. And it comes through very clearly whenever I hear her. That's probably what I like most about her. There's not a lot of fluff and frill. It's just real, you know, data-driven reality. And I actually like that a lot. I also learned today that because I went to the blended learning session, and I believe that my school and my classroom were on the right track for really helping all kids achieve, uncovering their strengths and really building on those, and giving them the time they need to do what they need to do in order to succeed. So I feel like we're on the right track.
Kiowa Cares represents a really unique way and an organized way for folks who live here on Kiowa to connect, partner, and help those who live in our neighborhood, which includes Johns and Wabala Island.
And the idea was that many, many people who live on Kiowa very generously work as individuals in the community, but we felt as a community association, we needed to do more in a unified way to be good neighbors. And out of that came the idea of Kiowa Cares.
They brought volunteers, but most of all, they brought love. They showed love and they said, we want to be a good neighbor, and they have been a good neighbor to me and to this community.
Kiowa Cares quickly jumped on board and was really excited about the idea of supporting the local farmers and supporting the Johns Island community as well.
We're excited about the partnership, and we are in constant communication, updating them on things that that we are working on, areas where I continue to see improvement, I share with them. And so it's like we are in tune, working together, one common goal, and it's all beginning to come together.
What it means to me to be a part of Kiowa Cares is I'm able to do things I wouldn't normally have done on my own. I get the sense of community when I work with them.
We're trying to put good people in touch with organizations that could use their help.
Dr. Postlewaite wrapped up this symposium with a motivational message to all who attended.
We just wanted to leave you with a couple of thoughts. A few years ago, referring to the technological revolution, Alvin Toffler wrote, "A new day is dawning, and blind men everywhere are rushing to push it back." I think that sums up what it's like to deal with change in a system where people are accustomed to schooling. We have to transform our system from a system of schooling that continues to do everything we used to do when it doesn't work for many children, to a system of learning, making sure that all of our children are growing, and that growth is continuous, and it's supported, and it's intentional, and that we're responsive. So thank you for coming here this morning to talk about readiness, to talk about relationships, to talk about relevance and responsiveness. We pledge to you that if you registered for today's session, at least every 2 weeks for the rest of the school year, you will hear from us. We will be in touch with you about the continued work we're doing and the progress we're making and any challenges that we meet along the way. If you've stepped forward this morning and said you want to be part of that work, you'd like to help continue plan in some of the groups, we've taken that information and rest assured we'll be back in touch with you. As we leave here today, I'd like to just think for a little bit about the words of William Butler Yeats when he wrote, "Had I heaven's claws inwrought with silver and gold threads, valuable beyond all means, I would spread those claws beneath your feet. But I, being poor, have no claws, so I'll spread my dreams beneath your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams." The children in our district have dreams. Let us step forward confidently and carefully and respectfully as we dream and do on behalf of Charleston County's youth. Thank you all again for your thoughts, your contributions, your caring, and your commitment. Thank you.
Some problems are tough. Reaching your customers shouldn't be.
Blue Wave and Comcast have the creative edge to make you stand out from the crowd and connect with your customers. Whether you need a commercial for television, video for your website, or a custom-made website, we are the easy solution for every advertising problem.
What an awesome show. We've had presenters from all across the nation to come here and talk about the best strategies for our kids in Charleston County School District. This has been an awesome symposium. There will be many, many more to come. We thank you for watching. We want you to stay connected to CCSD, and we'll see you next week.